We're going to be in 2 Samuel today, so if you want to bookmark that, go ahead. But I want you to turn to Lamentations, and if you want to listen to the children's sermon, listen to the children's sermon. But I want you to look at Lamentations, the 5 chapters, and I want you to tell me the peculiar thing that you'll see about Lamentations, because I'm going to go over that real quick as I open my message.
I got some sinus thing going on. Has anybody else got the sinus thing going on? So that medicine, I got to drink water, so you have to drink water. I got home from school last night. I was on midnight, or I would be on midnight, so I'll be able to work tonight at 6 o'clock. But
I think you adapt even that internal clock. But to make a long story short, I went to the hotel. I was in there, and I tried to get to sleep. I couldn't get to sleep. I looked at the clock. It was 3:27. That's the last thing I remembered. And at 4 o'clock, I woke up, and I couldn't get back to sleep. So I went 30 minutes on 2 days, and then last night we had the wedding and then the reception. I went home. I told Barry, I said, "We got to get home. I got to do my sermon." So I did my sermon. I woke up. God changed a little bit of it, and He added some more to it. Don't freak out. It's not that long. But it surprised me because she didn't know what I was preaching on. I didn't know what her sermon was going to be on. And she's talking about being focused, and I'm talking about the message and the messenger today. How many of y'all looked at Lamentations and found anything peculiar about it? What?
I have. It's the message of hope. Can I read these verses? Mm-hmm. This I recall to my mind, and therefore I have hope. It is of the Lord's mercy that we are not consumed, because His compassion fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, saith my soul. Therefore I will hope in Him. The Lord is good unto him that wait for him, the soul that is sick of him.
You know, it's funny. I was supposed to talk about Lamentations this morning, and I forgot about it. And then I had that song, and I noticed Lamentations on the top. And I said, "Thank you, God, for reminding me." And then she read the very verse that we sung. Is that a coincidence? I don't think so. I believe in coincidences, but not when it involves God. I've said that before. Go ahead.
Here's your thing. It's 4 of 5 chapters, like 22 verses a piece.
That's right.
It's yep. The number of letters in the Hebrew alphabet. Mm-hmm.
And why is that? Why are the verses like that? Now, Lamentations was written by the leftovers, the people that weren't taken into captivity. This is after the third destruction of Israel. The only people that are there left is Jeremiah and the remnants of people that I guess they just figured weren't good enough to be slaves and didn't want anything to do with. And they sat down and they started writing about all their problems and the reason why these things did that. And how they did it, if you notice, like he said, is that each chapter has 22 verses in it, except for chapter 3. Now, what is 3 times 22? 66. There's 66 verses in chapter 3. What they did is when they wrote Lamentations, and I believe, and I'm going to be showing you how there's an influence by God and human in the Bible. You're going to say, "Oh, I already know that." But I want to show you why today, okay? Now, these people were suffering something terrible. And you just imagine if somebody came to Paris and took everything out of the banks, robbed all the houses, killed most of the people, and those that they didn't kill, they left with. The female people of your family were tortured and things happened to them, and your children were killed and taken captive, and then it happened again, and then it happened again. You were sitting here basically left alone, and there you had one honest prophet of God with you, and he's keeping you on your feet. How would you feel? And if you started to write about it, how would you write? Well, you know, when that things happen, you have hatred in your heart, don't you? You have sorrow, you have hatred, you have confusion, you want to lash out. So what God had them do is when they started a verse, because there's 22 letters in the ancient Hebrew alphabet, they started the verse with their A. And then they went to B and went to C. So it would be sort of like if we wrote something, it would be like, "Always before me are my sins." And then the next would be, "Because I have sinned against the Lord, these things have happened." And then the third would be like, "Carelessness has crossed my mind, and death and destruction." So you see how it was written? So what God is saying is that there is a proper way to do everything, is He not? He's saying that there has to be order and a proper way, even when you lament, even when you cry, there's a right way to do it and a wrong way to do it, no matter what your emotion. There's a right way and a wrong way to give a message and to receive a message, okay? And I'm going to be talking about the message and the messenger. How many of y'all noticed... some people call them discrepancies. I call them differences in the Gospels. You know, you've got one that talks this way about Jesus, and then one that gives a completely different story about Jesus. And if you want to find a contradiction in the Bible, you're going to find it. Okay? But if you want to find God in the Bible, you're going to find God, but you got to do it the right way, right? You got to look at the Bible in the right aspect. Now, what I want to talk about is the human part of the Bible. A lot of people put God so high on a pedestal that they can't reach him. Y'all understand what I'm saying? You want to put God so high, and he deserves to be as high as we can get him, but I'm talking about you put him higher than you can reach, okay? Sure, the Bible didn't say that he won't put anything on us more than we can stand, but he did say, I'll not put anything on you more than I can stand, amen?
Amen.
So God is there. But we tend to do that. I'm going to tell you something else that you shouldn't do. You should never take your problems to God. How many of y'all believe that? Everybody's been hearing, you need to take your problems to God. Well, you remember the service that I did where I said that Jesus' problem was that he was trying to agree in a way with the Pharisees and scribes, but he was saying it in a different way. That they said that water and flour make no, but he was saying no, it makes bread, because he was thinking of the finished works, wasn't he? Well, I want to talk to you about the finished works and why you shouldn't take your problems to God. Has anybody ever seen somebody that was in a state and they were like, I can't breathe, I can't breathe? Have y'all ever seen that? I see it a lot at work. Some people get dog bit or hit by a car or something, and whether they're hurt bad or not, and they'll be just panting, and they'll say, I can't breathe, I can't breathe. And I'm like, look, if you're talking, you're breathing. Okay? That's why your chest is doing that. You know, especially when you see someone that's going through an anxiety attack. Has anybody had one? I've had one. And you're, I can't breathe, I don't know what, and you're like, look, you're breathing, okay? Calm down. But you know what? You're getting the air that you need to survive, and you are breathing, but you don't know what you're doing, because you've got your concentration on the fear, okay? Whatever it is that caused you to fear, that's where your concentration is. You're breathing, don't even know it, okay? When you carry your cares to God, like this, what's going to happen in that prayer? What's going to happen in that Bible reading that you're doing that day? The only thing you're focused on is what's right in front of you, is your problem. You're not focusing on God's love. You're not focusing on God's attention. You're not focusing on what God wants. All you're focusing on is your problem. Now, does God know about your problems? He knows about them before you get them, don't he? He knows about when you get them. He knows about how to handle them, right? So can we trust God with our problems? So instead of walking to him like this, with our problems in our hand, why don't we walk to him like this and keep our problems behind us and trust him so much that when we get to him, we can say, God, I love you, and I want to concentrate on that right now. I want to concentrate on your son and your spirit and your word. I want to concentrate on my relationship with you and how strong it is to find the weak parts and have you change them. And then look at God and say, God, is there anything that you need me to do? Is there anything that you need me to change? Is there anything that you need to tell me? Now, let me ask you a question. How many of you here, seriously, I don't know his arms broke because I don't see any slings. How many of you here believe that if you put God first in prayer and God first in your reading of the Bible and you ask him what he wants, that he won't take care of your problem or give you advice on the problem before you leave it? Won't he? So there are things that the Gospels tell us, and we say, well, this is God's Word. People come up and say, well, if it's God's Word, why does that contradict that? Why does that contradict that? And we say, I don't know, but it's God's Word. It's God's Word, so it's infallible. But do you know that there's some things in God's Word that are valuable only because God allowed the human part of us to be in there? I've said it before, and I'll say it again. Never has it been meant for us to do anything by ourselves. You got God, who said, let there be light. Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, came into heaven, didn't he? What did he say when Adam was by himself? It's not good that he should be alone, right? What did Jesus say? I want you with me so that when I'm with God, we could all be together. We were never meant to do anything by ourselves. At the same note, we were also meant to be human beings, were we not? If God didn't say it was a good thing, he wouldn't have said it was good, would he? Heaven, earth, and humanity, good, good. As a matter of fact, we hit the category where he says very good. Okay? God loves us. You know, we're heir and joint heirs. We get the same thing Christ does. How special does that make you feel? So you got to remember that when you read the Bible, yes, God authored that Bible. He inspired that Bible. The Holy Spirit was with them when they wrote. but God allowed them to write it their way. I know that's hard to grasp, but I want you to remember, I'm going to tell you the finished works of this sermon, okay? And I want you to understand why Matthew talked about this, and Mark talked about that, and John talked about that, and it can seem disillusioned at times. But when I tell you these things, I want you to think about this the whole time I'm talking. God picked a particular time and a particular man to do a particular job for Jesus. Okay? Do you ever wonder why Jesus come at that time and not now or some other time? It's because of Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Paul, Peter. It's because everything had to be in order, and that particular time was the only time that them things could be in order. Okay? How many of y'all, when you read the New Testament, you think that it's being written right there? And it wasn't written for years and years and years and years after his death and resurrection. And there's a reason for that too. So I want to talk to you about the human side of Jesus. Then I want to talk to you about the true and the fake messengers, those that you hear preaching the word, okay? And I hope that I stand out well when I speak about that. But I'm going to talk quick because I don't want this to be long. It's not really that long. But how do you see Jesus? When you picture Jesus, you picture a man, don't you? Right? I mean, you picture that picture right back there with the disciples. Okay? So when you picture Jesus on the cross, do you picture God's love? I do. I see God's love when I see Jesus hanging on the cross. When I see a picture of Jesus' resurrection, I picture the power of God and the power of the Holy Spirit. When I see Jesus with some lambs around him and little children on him, I see the caring nature of God. When I see Jesus at the Last Supper, I see the part of Jesus who is giving. Okay? When I see Jesus and pictures of him on the mount, I picture the Word of God. So we had to have this human come here to show us who God was, did we not? We had the apostles before, I preached on it, who showed us who Jesus was, but somebody had to come and show us who God was and fulfill that. We take too much of the human out of the Bible. God meant for us to be with him in human form. That's why it's important not to do that. Instead of taking humanity out of it, remember that humans wrote it, God inspired it, authored it, and when we start seeing that part of it, because Matthew wasn't perfect, was he? But he wrote a book in the Bible, didn't he? Luke, John, controversy on some. But as I talk and tell you about these people, I want you to visualize, wow, that's why Matthew was picked. Out of all the people, that's why he picked Matthew. That's why he picked Paul. You know, Paul was very important to the gospel. I think as a preacher, there's no greater preacher that ever has been or ever will be other than Jesus Christ. Can y'all agree with that? I'm going to need some amen buttons to put on you guys so that, like, in that movie, you see the easy button, and they hit the button, and he goes, that's easy. I'm going to walk by and start hitting buttons. Amen, amen, amen. But if I had to pick, personally, a number two, I would pick Paul, even though people fell asleep during his messages. I think he's one of the, he's second to Jesus in preaching. And if you notice, he had a lot of peculiarities. He grew up in a big city. And if you notice, when he wrote and where he went places, it was always to big cities. And he was one of them who believed that the world is only 10% of what hits me and 90% of how I react to it. That's one of the reasons why God picked him, because he knew that he was going to be spending some time in prison and he was going to be writing about this time to encourage others. So you can see where God took him. He was taught as a rabbi. He spoke both to the Jews and Gentiles. God needed somebody to stand up and say, no, I know the scripture. You're not fooling me. Christ has risen, and it is here, and written here, and written here. Many show, hey, feel glad today and feel blessed today. If you read about Paul when he was in prison in that house, and people come to him, he preached from morning to night. You've only got me for an hour. Okay? But how did these gospel writers see Jesus? Keep these things in mind. Matthew, he saw Jesus as the king of the Jews. Okay? Who did he preach to mostly? The Jews, didn't he? And who were they waiting for? Messiah. When you read Matthew, you can see how Matthew writes is reflected on the way he sees Jesus as the King of the Jews. Mark saw Jesus as a servant, as a humble servant, somebody who would take care of you if you trusted in him. Luke was a doctor. Y'all know that, right? If you look at the way Luke writes, you can see where he talks about more of Jesus' humanity and the humanity around him than he does anything else. He sees Jesus as the ideal human, a divine human. He does see him as God's son, but he portrays him in his writings as more human because he's a doctor. And I'm going to go over a few of the things about that. John just says, this is the Son of God. I mean, there's no bones about it, okay? Remember, John was the one at the cross, and Jesus said, woman, behold thy son, you behold your mother. So you think that the time that he spent with Mary might have influenced him in his writing and how he saw Jesus? Sure he did. She talked about when she was visited by the angels, immaculate conception, all the quirky little things that Jesus did when he was little, probably about how she walked by his crib and she could hear him speaking in a plain voice to God. Or how she might have walked by his crib one night and heard him speaking in tongues to God in a language that she didn't know. She might have walked by his crib and actually saw angels standing around him. Wouldn't that be something to see that? I mean, there's so much that we don't know about that the Bible hasn't told us, but that would be so, so beautiful. So Mark, and as I read this, I want you to sort of, I'm saying this because this was a last-minute thing. I'm going to do a little read. I want you to think about the last time you read Mark and see if this doesn't coincide with what you do. And the purpose for Mark's writings was that he saw that Jesus was the person when you had a need, that he was a servant. Mark was talking to Greeks and Gentiles and other people who were going through a war at this time. He was talking to people who were hungry, who'd seen family and friends killed and who were sick. So when Mark talked, he said, I know you're hungry. Let me tell you the story about when Jesus fed the thousands. I know you're sick. Let me tell you the story when Jesus healed people. So Mark talked about being the servant. He talked about Jesus and how he acted amidst a crisis. Jesus saw a leper. Jesus cleansed a leper. Jesus saw a broken bone, he healed a broken bone. Jesus saw somebody possessed, and he exercised that. When Jesus saw a need, he did it because he was the servant. That's the way Mark wrote. Matthew, some of y'all know Matthew. Some of y'all might be Matthew. He was one of them guys that the big book started here, and everything had to go down in the line. He was a guy where everything had a place, and he wanted everything in its place. So he was a particular guy. One of the longest writers. If you've ever noticed in Matthew, not like the other Gospels, when Jesus gets done doing something, he talks about how Jesus left. He did this, and then he went on to this place. And he did this, and he went on to that place. He was very organized. He wanted people to know that Jesus just didn't hang around, that Jesus had a purpose, and that purpose in life. And he did that, and then he went here, and he went there. He spoke about the fulfillment of the Old Testament. Why? Because he saw Jesus as the King of the Jews, and he spoke with the Jews, and they were still in the Old Testament. New Testament hadn't been written and won't be written for another 30, 40 years. The way of righteousness was very important to Matthew, okay? So much so that he spoke about the rejection of righteousness. You remember when Mary, when she found out she was pregnant, she went to Joseph, he rejected her and wanted to put her away privately. You remember the story about the husbandmen that took care of the vineyards, and when he sent his righteous son, they killed him and threw him out. Remember when they killed John the Baptist? This is a rejection of righteousness. Righteousness was very important to Matthew, and that's why you can see these things in his writing. Luke, they believe that the same person that wrote Luke wrote Acts. And people say, well, didn't Luke write Luke? I believe he did, but there's a lot of people that think that there were pseudo-authors and other people that put things in with Luke's writings. But you can see a really close resemblance in the writings of Luke and Acts, so much so that you could be led to believe, and I do, that they are both written by the same person. Now, Luke, if you notice, he included all the outcasts, all those that nobody else wanted. He was the only one that wrote about the Good Samaritan. He's the one that wrote about Zacchaeus and the publicans and the people that Jesus went to see that no one else wanted to be around. Remember, Luke was a physician. So Luke was looking after the body. Luke wrote more. You know what, women, if you want a favorite book, pick Luke, because he talked about women more than he did anybody else. And he put them on the same level. Why? Because he was a physician and he looked at the body. He didn't see anything different. You know, you have a heart, Rose, I have a heart. You know, you might be tall or whatever, but you're still the same in Luke's eyes. He looked at the physical part, so much so that he spent a lot of time with self-denial. He's the one that wrote about the rich man, the little rich young man, and Jesus said, sell all you have to be with me. Fast. Go fast. You know, deny yourself to be with God. You know, he talked a lot about the human side of man. Prayer life. He talked about Jesus' prayer life. Everybody talked about the Mount of Transfiguration, but he was the only one to talk why they went there in the first place, and that was for Jesus to pray. Amen. Now, John is unique to John. John's a maverick. John was the last one written. He was the youngest of those Gospels. He took Mary in. He was the only one that died of natural causes. The other ones were martyred to death. And he wrote all of his later on in life. You'll notice that there are no exorcism stories in John, and there are no parables in John. There are references to them, but there's no parables. He always talked about Jesus in the first person. I am the good shepherd. I am the vine. I am the bread of life. I am, I am. And he said, I am, seven times in his Gospels. He also didn't say miracle. He said signs. What does a sign represent? It represents what's there, right? There was a lot of people that were claiming to do miracles then. He didn't want Jesus associated with anybody but God, because how did he look at him? He looked at him as the Son of God. This is a sign of him being the Son of God. He's not just a miracle worker, he's a sign from God. Everything he does is a sign that he is the Son of God. All of them talked about feeding the multitude, but he was the only one to talk about turning water into wine. He always talked about the hour and mysticism. How many of y'all know mysticism? I'm a little critical, can raise your hand on that. The hour, not just the time, but he was combining prophecy, saying, this is the hour of the Lord. This is the hour of God. Jesus said, it's not the hour yet. And you know, you can't take him because they couldn't take him because the hour had not come. And now is the time. This is your hour. That is because it was prophesied. It wasn't just a time. It was a time it was supposed to be. And mysticism, you know, he talked about how you could be a part of God and God could be a part of you. And you could, not just in time, but in physicality. He talked about how Jesus said, I am the bread of life. You need to eat my flesh and drink my blood. He talked about, like the Pentecostals do, when they speak tongues, they're sharing the Spirit of God. And how we share the same spirit, and how we should be in one spirit, and how we have that thing to do. When we get messages from God, we can give them or get them without speaking. How many of y'all believe that? I mean, you like Rose, she's like, my message is you're confused, okay? Some of you, my message is you're tired because you're sleeping. You know, I don't think preachers take sleeping as a discourse and when they preach, because Paul had them falling asleep with him, okay? And I don't mind it. I don't mind when kids talk. I don't mind when they yell and scream and run around. I don't mind it when people are, you can tell they're a million miles away. You know what I hate worse than anything in church? When people are talking to other people. I've seen people actually turn around and put their arm up there and start talking and be doing this. If I see that go on, I'm going to stop preaching. And I'm going to wait until you get done, and then I'm going to ask you, like a teacher would in class, what was more important than God's message today? I don't care if it's a death in a family. It's not important, more important than God's message. If they're dead, they ain't coming back alive until you get a chance to talk to them after church, are they? I mean, that sounds a little cruel, but, and I'm not talking about somebody that's correcting your child or wanting to pick your child up, or even somebody saying, hey, what did they say, what did, you know, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about people that just don't care about the message sent from God and by God. So that, have, now I'm going to start preaching. Come on. I'm going to do this really quick because we're speaking of messages, are we not? We all give messages and we receive messages, and it's important how we give them and how we receive them. I'm going to read this really quick after I take another slug of water, and I want you to try to think and put yourself in a position, you know, like you're watching a movie. Visualize what's going on. Now, Amaz, son of Zadok, said, and remember, Zadok was the father of most priests, and Amaz was a priest, and if I'm not saying it the way you would say it, don't worry about it, I was going to call him Herbie to begin with. Let me run and take the news to the king. Now, this is after Absalom's army had been defeated and Absalom was killed. Let me run and take the news to the king that the Lord has vindicated him by delivering him from the hand of his enemies. You are not able to take the news today, Joab told him. You may take the news another time, but you must not do so today because the king's son is dead. Then Joab said to the Cushite, who's an African warrior and maybe a slave, go tell the king what you have seen. The Cushite bowed down and Joab, before Joab, ran off. Amaz, the son of Zadok, again said to Joab, come what may, please let me run behind the Cushite. But Joab replied, my son, why do you want to go? You don't have any news that will bring you a reward. He said, come what may, I want to run. So Joab said, run. Then Amaz ran by the way of the plain and outran the Cushite. While David was sitting between the inner and outer gates, the watchman went up to the floor, or up to the roof of the gateway by the wall. As he looked out, he saw a man running alone. The watchman called out to the king and reported it. The king said, if he's alone, he must have good news. And the runner came closer and closer. Then the watchman saw another runner. He called down to the gatekeeper, look, another man running alone. The king said, he must be bringing good news too. The watchman said, it seems to me that the first one runs like Amaz, the son of Zadok. He's a good man, the king said. He comes with good news. Then Amaz called out to the king, all is well. He bowed down before the king, fell on his face to the ground, and said, praise be the Lord God. He has delivered up those who lifted their hands against my lord the king. The king asked, is the young man Absalom saved? Amaz answered, I saw great confusion just as Joab was about to send the king's servant and me, your servant, but I don't know what it was. What was he told before he left? The king said, stand aside and wait here. So we stepped aside and stood there. Then the Cushite arrived and said, my lord the king, hear the good news. The Lord has vindicated you today by delivering you from the hand of all those that rose up against you. The king asked the Cushite, is the young man Absalom saved? The Cushite replied, may the enemies of my lord the king and all who rise to harm him be like that young man. The king was shaken, and he went up to the upper room, up to the room over the gateway and wept. As he went, he said, oh, my son Absalom, if only I had died instead of you, oh, Absalom, my son. You know, you got preachers that never speak about hell. You got preachers that never want to speak about anything that's going to get people upset at. And I don't know if God picked this particular time for me to talk about this because I'm supposed to tell y'all that you got to vote for me to stay or leave. But you have this priest who says, I want to go tell him about the battle. And you have Joab, the captain of his army, saying, look, this is bad news. His son's been killed. You don't need to be going to tell him this news. You can go talk to him after he gets it. Y'all remember what David did when they told him that Saul was dying? He killed the messengers, didn't he? So you can either get a reward for bringing good news or you can get killed for saying bad news. That's probably why he sent the Cushite. He wasn't Jewish. He was a warrior, but probably a slave warrior. And he said, if anybody's going to get killed, it's not going to be one of my men. So you go and tell him the bad news. You got to hand it to this Cushite, though. Like many preachers today, he doesn't care. If he's going to be put in a place by his master to do something, he's going to do it. All right? So he walked up to the king, and he probably said, hey, good news. They're up. They're gone. Your army has defeated the army that rose up against you. And he said, what about my son Absalom? Did his demeanor change? I don't see it. Not only that, but he said, may everyone who comes up against you, may it happen to them like it did to that man. Like, you know, we really done him in good. I guess he knew he was going to die. He said, I'm going to die. I'm going to die. How many of y'all ever seen preachers didn't care whether they got kicked out of a church or not? They were going to give the news away it was supposed to be given by God, right? You know, when I give you a message, God preached it to me first. And I have to listen to God's message. And then I preach it to you. But the problem is a lot of preachers today, when they hear a message, they don't realize that the message is probably for them more than the church. And they need to listen to God and pay more attention. Right? So you have this guy. What did he say? I'm going to run behind him. But what does it say in the story he did? He overtook him, didn't he? He wanted to get there first to give him the good news. He wanted that pat on the back. But you know what really sticks out in my mind is the way David acted. Here comes a runner. Oh, if it's only one guy, there must be good news. Well, here comes another one. But he's alone too. Well, then he must have good news too. Oh, the one looks like the priest. Oh, well, he's a good guy. He must have good news. How many of y'all ever got to call somebody in a wreck or somebody's gone to the doctor's office? And the whole time you're waiting for the news about what's happening, you're thinking to yourself all these reasons why you're going to get good news. Y'all ever do that? Let me tell you something. The hardest thing in the world is when you're standing in a hospital after a bad wreck and somebody's either hurt really bad or they're dead and it's the child of somebody and then parents come in. Now let me tell you, if I get emotional, I'm picturing some of these scenes that I've been through. But they come in and you can see that they've been battling. And they got hope. And with this hope, they're like, what's going on? What happened? Where's my son? Where's my daughter? All right? And you say, they're going to be okay. They're hurt, but they're going to be okay. And you can see the hope leave. And they get weak. That hope was their strength. That's why we hope in the Lord. Amen? That hope was their strength. It upheld them. People come in. And they had that hope. Everything's going to be okay. Surely, there's reasons why they should be alive. I've done this, I've done that. I've prayed, all these things. And then they come in and they say, what's going on? What's happened? You say, I'm sorry, but your son or your daughter was killed. And it's the same exact reaction. Why? Because the same hope that held both of them up is now gone. That's why we should hope on the Lord, right? But never let that hope leave you. Because it's what holds us up. But that hope leaves, and one, you have a relief. The other one, you have torment and tears. But the hope is gone that held them up. David had this hope. I hope, I hope, I hope. Finding reasons why these things should be good. And then they get that message. You have too many people that aren't taking a stand in church. You have too many pastors not taking a stand. You have too many parents that aren't taking a stand. Let me tell you, Jesus said, I'd rather you be hot or cold, not lukewarm, or I'll spew you out of my mouth. Okay? Now, what did Jesus tell people earlier? He said, it's not the things you take in that defile you, but the things that come out. So even something warm isn't going to defile you. What he's saying is that you're no good. You're worthless. In a desert, desert people don't just spit water out. Even if it's lukewarm. What he's saying is that if you're not on fire or you're not cold, you're worthless to me. And why is that? Anybody want to take a guess? If you're somebody who's hot, you're somebody who's made a choice. You've made a stand. If you're somebody who's cold, you are somebody who's made a stand, right? You get people that are willing to make a stand, you can change their mind. And if you change their mind, then they're going to go from cold to hot. They're not going to be wishy-washy. It's these pastors and preachers and people that get out here and they want to try to be wishy-washy. They want to try to take God's word and they want to turn it around. Or they want to give you only the good news to get the pat on the back and wait for the next guy to come and give the bad news. Each one of you are messengers in this world. How you approach people. Like I said, when you see Jesus on a cross, we can see the love of God. When we see him at the dinner table with the 12 disciples, we see how he feeds the world. We see his grace when we see him with somebody and he's preaching it to them. What do people see? What message do you give people about Jesus when they see you, when they hear you talk, the way you talk, the things that you do? We are only human. We can't beat ourselves up for making a mistake or saying something or doing something wrong. We have forgiveness for, but we still need to remember that we are human beings and we are writing a story just like the Gospels did about Jesus, and how we act and what we do is the way people see Jesus in us. But one thing about this story that sticks out in my mind is back then when a messenger came with a message, everybody shut up. Even the king was quiet. Why? Because that person's message meant life and death, poverty or riches, winning a war or losing a war. You've got people, like the time when it talked about Jesus. I think I got a verse here. I don't know. Let me see. Yeah, in Luke 4:16 it says that Jesus went to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue. As was his custom, he stood up and read. They didn't want to hear it from Jesus because later on he talks about how he read the prophecy about how he was the Savior and he was coming, and they said, "Who does this guy think he is?" And they kicked him out of the church. How many times does somebody bring a message to you in church and you kick him out of your head? You take Jesus out of your head. Just like they kicked him out of the church because you heard it 1,000 times. We hear stories about how Jesus would sigh about things. And mostly it was over unbelief. We all sigh about things. But when you go to church, do you sigh about relatives that you love that aren't in church today? Do you sigh about friends that aren't in church today? Do you sigh about a lost world? Or do you sigh about the length of a sermon? Or do you sigh because this is the same one you've heard 1,000 times? You know, God hears our sighs as much as he hears our laughter and our pain and our joys and everything else. And it tells a lot about us, our sighs do. I'm going to close with Hebrews chapter 11. All right, let me hear it. Talking of people that were messengers to God, some faced jeers and flogging, and even chains and imprisonment. Now it's just backstabbings, and his hair is too long, his tie is too ugly, or you don't have enough hair. They were put to death by stoning. They were imprisoned. They were sawed in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins and destitute, persecuted and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains, living in caves and in holes and in the ground. You don't have to be the pastor of a church to be a messenger of God. You don't have to be an evangelist or a missionary to be a messenger of God. All you've got to be as a messenger of God is to hear the message that God has for you and take it to somebody else. Our gracious Heavenly Father, I thank you for this time, God, where we can hear your message. I pray that I haven't failed you. God, I did my best, as good as it can be, but I know that there's a human element in this message that was delivered, and because I'm human, I don't have that quality that Christ had. I pray that one day, God, that I'll be able to sit up in heaven and listen to him give a sermon. I thank you so much, God, that you've given me the privilege to be here to give a message. I thank you for those that are here to listen to the message. I hope that they heard something, God, that will get them to see the Gospels in a different way, to understand it. That you had these particular men, God, to see things in a particular way about Jesus. We need to see Jesus as the Son of God. We need to see Jesus as the King of the Jews. We need to see Jesus as the servant. And we need to see Jesus in all these different ways. And I want to thank you for seeing these things in these people so long ago that they were able to bring all these things in the gospel so that we could get a view of Jesus in a way that is not one-sided. And I thank you that they wrote what was passionate to them about Jesus because it shows how Jesus affected their lives. I know if each one of us wrote something about Jesus, that it would be different from one another. I want to thank you for waiting for them to write them Gospels 30, 40 years afterwards so that they had time to think about them. I know that if we wrote about something about Jesus when we were 10, it wouldn't be the same as when we were 20, or it wouldn't be the same if we were 40. So we know, God, that these Gospels were written by the perfectly chosen men at the perfectly chosen time to let us see Jesus in so many ways that we're grateful for. We ask your blessings upon this message and upon those that have heard it. And God, we ask you to go with us and be with us today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Be my
While our sister's still praying, I just want to remind you not to carry your problems with God, because you know that wherever you go, your problems are with you, aren't they? They're going to make their way to God. They don't need your help to get there. Put your heart out there first and not your problems. Put your will to do His will out there first. And you'll see more problems and more stress and more pain leave you quicker than you ever have in your life. Why? Because when your problems are behind you, remember, they're not going to leave you. When you go to God, your problems are going to follow you. So let them follow you. Don't let them rule you. Don't let them lead you. Okay? Don't let your problems determine your path in life. Let God determine that path. And then when you get to God, I guarantee you, your problems will get solved. Because you're concentrating more on the man that knows how to fix them than on the problems. Amen?
Amen.
I want to have the privilege of dismissing us in prayer today. Gracious Heavenly Father, I thank you so much, God, for this time that we've had together. God, I've asked in the last prayer that you go with us and be with us, and I ask that again. I know that with our problems, we just can't dump them on you and try to leave them, because you said, I want to do everything with you. I know, God, that we were never meant to do anything alone, and your intent isn't to take everything from us, but to be with us and with us fight these problems. That's why it's called the whole armor of God, because you go with that armor. It's not our armor, it's our armor. All of ours together. Your armor and my armor. I know, God, that I can't take claim of it myself, and I know that you don't want me to. So when I have that helmet and that sword and that shield and my feet shod, I know that you're with me. If you weren't, I wouldn't have the power and the armor would be useless. So let us, God, go to you, concentrate on you, listen to you, so that you can help us with the problems of our lives, so that we can hear the messages that you have for us, so that we have problems that we don't know about yet, we'll know about them before they happen. And when they do happen, we'll know how to take care of them. And we'll have that peace that passeth all understanding. Why? Because we've already heard your message, and we put our trust in you. In Jesus' name, amen.